Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 34 for the 20th of March, 2022. A couple of people have asked me this week, actually five people have asked me this week, either via email or private messages of some variety, what I use for shooting and for editing these videos. Well, I've got some information on that. So we're going to start off with a little tour of what I use to make the videos.
This is the Canon HFR80 setup that I use. You'll see I've got it on a light stand. And I've got the ring light mounted to that on a tilt head. And then the camera is mounted on a little ball head that comes with the light, the ring light unit. Ring light is off at the moment. You can see if I'm going to turn it on low and I'm going to swing through. You can see you can adjust the color temperature of the ring light, and if I crank it up, it's just going to get blindingly bright, so I'm going to turn it off at the moment. Anyway, I like the little camcorder. It's not the most fancy one in the world. When I bought it new a couple of years ago. It was sub $300. I think it actually costs more on the used market now than it did when it was new, but there's a couple things I like about it. I'm going to swing around to the back here. There is an HDMI out, and it uses the mini HDMI connector, and I run a cable from that HDMI over to a Vixia 24-inch TV, and you can see on the television display, actually you can see me speaking, the VU meter. What's coming out of that HDMI when you're in camera mode is everything that would normally be seen on the little viewfinder. So to make it a lot easier for me to see what the heck I'm doing, I've got that on this monitor, which is on a nice mount that moves around so I can position it so I can see what I'm doing. Sometimes you see it gets in the camera shot. I'm not overly concerned about that, but it works fairly well. I'm quite happy with it. And of course, being a smart TV, what's nice about it is when I am not making a video, I've got Netflix, Disney Plus, Amazon Prime, a bunch of other crap. I can watch movies while I'm working at my bench doing something else when I'm not actually making a video, or I could just, you know, play music. So I like it. It works out well. And I have it on a mount that's attached to the wall. It's fully articulated, goes anywhere I want. It works really, really well. Back to the camera. There is some limited internal storage, which I don't use. It uses standard SD cards. I keep a battery on it only because if I accidentally hit the power, unplug the power supply, which I've done more than once, it's uninterrupted and the camera keeps on going. So it also keeps the battery nicely charged up. But I'm quite happy with this little camcorder. I'm going to get another one of them, or something equivalent to it, because I'm building another shop. Well, I'm not building another shop. I have another shop out in the garage, and I'm building a polishing and buffing station out there so I can get some of the dirtier work out of this room, which is in the main living portion of the house. So anyway, yeah, the whole system with monitors and everything, that works out quite well. I wholeheartedly recommend getting wall mounts if you're going to do something like this. It makes life so much easier.
I do my editing on a Dell Inspiron 7506 2-in-1 laptop. It's got an 11th gen Intel Core i7 1165 G7 processor. I've got 16 gigabytes of RAM running, and it has a 1 terabyte SSD in it, which is more than enough for day-to-day use. Attached to that, I have a lot of other storage. I have a Seagate 8 terabyte backup system that stays attached to the computer the entire time. Anytime I save a file on my local machine, it automatically gets backed up onto that 8 terabyte drive. That's kind of important to me, having had laptops that have gone poof in the night in the past. I also have multiple USB hard drives. I've got a little 2 terabyte and a little 5 terabyte that I pretty much keep tagged on all the time. And I'll back up camera originals to that, or completed videos, or whatever. Anyway, the software that I'm using, I use a couple of different things, actually. For editing, like I said, I use Corel Video Studio. Right now, I'm using version 2022. It's not something that Corel originally developed. That was originally a ULEAD product. It's a really nice nonlinear editor. They keep on adding more and more features to it. It's really, really a great value for the money. I think this latest upgrade was like $63, but the whole package is, you know, sub 200 bucks if you're starting out from scratch. There's a lot of add-ins you can get for it, but what I love more than, almost as much as how much I like the package itself, what I like is it's not a subscription-based. If I didn't feel like upgrading from the first version of it I bought back in 2020, I could still be using that one. It's not like one of these things where, you know, you have to pay every month, or, you know, you get a year and then it times out. No, you buy it and you own it. I love that. Corel does have some stuff where they offer a subscription, like you can buy Corel Draw on a subscription plan. Honestly, I've got 3 different versions of Corel Draw installed. For editing just audio, well, first of all, if I have to record voiceover, usually what I do is I'll sit down at my computer. I have a Blue Yeti microphone. At the moment, it's on a desk stand. I want to put it on an overhead boom, but at the moment, it's on a desk stand. And I can either record that directly into Video Studio, but what I prefer to do is I record it into an extremely old version of SoundForge. For those who aren't up on audio editing packages, this version I'm using, I think, goes back to, if I'm not mistaken, 1998. I'm using a version I bought way back when. It's version 4.5. I don't even know if that company's still around. All I know is it works fantastic. I like it as an editor. I have used it extensively for decades now. It's a great package, and it too works in Windows 10. None of the help features will work, but I'm well beyond needing to hit the help screens. If I can't figure it out, then there's got to be something seriously wrong with me. But yeah, there's not that many apps that I really, really need. I can handle most of it, of what I do, on older audio and graphics application. The only thing I like keeping really up to date is my video. One of the cool things about doing YouTube and being in different forums online, you get to meet some great people, and really truly great friendships do develop. One example of that is our friend Pat down in Florida. Known Pat for a couple of years. We've sent machines back and forth. We've done all sorts of stuff. And we're just, I mean, Patty's like a sister to me now. And she and my wife are really close. But anyway, Patty found this stuff online. Autoglym, it's a resin type automotive polish. She got some, tried it, loved it, and she decided that we had to have some of it. So at Christmas time, she ordered that. Of course, shipping being what it is these days, it was slightly delayed. It arrived a few weeks ago, and I hadn't had really the right machine for it until recently. Last weekend I picked up this 99, and it was pretty grungy. But I was working on it this week, I decided, well, I was going to use the Autoglym, give it a try. I've got some footage from when I was working on the machine. I had a camera rolling the whole time with the intent of making a video of this. But anyway, I have some footage of my using the Autoglym for the first time. I looked at the footage the other night, and I was like, wow, okay, this is going to get a segment on Sunday Morning Quickies. So, kick back and enjoy this one. Our good friend, Patty, sent us, she had a bottle of this Autoglym sent to us. She says it's wonderful, she has tried it, she loves it. She wants us to give it a shot. So, here we go. Machine has been basically cleaned, which is, she said, all we need to really do. And it's still pulling some more dirt up, but just applying with circular motion. Okay. Let that dry. Overlapping circular motion. Let that dry down and see what it does. I only did a small area of it right here. Holy crap. She was right. Holy crap, was she right? Oh my God. Oh, wow. Patricia, you were right. All right. Let's give it a second dose. Keep in mind, this thing's been, hasn't been polished in a long time. Okay, we'll let that sit a little bit longer. Now, putting it on, I haven't to put it on anything on this side yet. All I've done on this side so far was just clean some of the crud off. Well, actually, what I did with the whole base was I cleaned the crud off with some sewing machine oil and a paper towel. Oh my God. Patty, you were so right. This stuff is phenomenal. Here's the untreated side. See how dull it is? And look at that. You saw what I just did. Go from that to that. Wow. Keep in mind, that's a polish, it's not a wax. That does a deep clean, does a loosening of dead paint and stuff like that, so it really brings the shine up. You really should use a good high-quality wax on top of it. Mother's Carnauba wax comes to mind. It's been kind of obvious in the last few videos that I've become quite an advocate for cleaning out the internal threads as well as the external threads on hardware. The external threads are easy enough to clean those using a rotary tool with a wire wheel to clean the threads out nice. And as has been seen in several videos recently, I've been using taps to clean out the to chase the internal threads of holes in the casting. to determine what those are, you generally need some sort of thread gauges. And we've had this set for, 30, 40 years, something like that. And these are okay. There's an SAE and there's a metric. Then I bought a really fancy one. I bought this at McMaster Car. This goes, this is not metric sizes. This is just imperial sizes. And it goes from what? It goes from 4 to 84 threads per inch. This one was a little on the expensive side. I think this particular thread gauge, I mean, it's a very nice one, but it was like $52. I was poking around on Amazon earlier this week, and I saw this set. Now, it was $20, so I said, eh, what the heck, you know. And I've always said, I buy things so you don't have to. Well, this is what it came with. I'll bring the camera over so you can see this better. So this is the package from Amazon. You have a, it comes with a 51 piece SAE gauge that goes from 4 and goes all the way up to 84 threads per inch. Pretty much standard style, you know, the triangular style with the all the additional leaves. Very much like the one I bought from McMaster Car, with the exception that this is considerably lighter weight material. It is stainless, though, but it's lighter weight material, and the locks are considerably smaller. But in its defense, this was $52, and this was part of a $20 set, so go figure. I mean, your mileage may vary. My mileage says, well, yeah, I would have bought this too. Anyway, it also comes with metric and Whitworth gauges broken out over these two smaller gauge sets. Unfortunately, it's not all metric and all Whitworth. They've got the sizes broken up between these two stacks. And it covers all of the sizes that you will ever see, and then some that you will never see. So anyway, that's the package. Like I said, it's about $20 on Amazon. It also included two little pouches for that. But I thought you guys might enjoy seeing that. This is going to be the true test to see whether or not I managed to keep Sunday morning quickies as something quick. Anyway, that's what I've got for you this week. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.